to the darkness. You give hope, you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only. Great are you, Lord. You give life, you are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope and you restore every heart that is broken. Great are you, Lord. It's your breath in our. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing. Great are you, Lord. All the earth will shout your praise. Our hearts will cry, these bones will sing.
Father God, we just thank you so much that you have brought us all here this morning to learn from you, to learn from your word, and to digest your truth and put it into practice in our lives. Father, I pray that you will do that for each of us this morning as we open your word. Father, show us exactly what you want us to learn this morning. Father, use me, get me out of your way so that your truth will be heard and understood. It is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, so our children this morning, they're having a wonderful time back there. They are learning about, they're continuing to learn about the life and ministry of Jesus. Particularly this morning, they're learning about when he was calling his disciples to come and follow him. And they're learning the story about when he called Matthew, the tax collector, to come and follow them. So it is a great lesson. I know one of the classes had some little chocolate coins since they're tax collectors and they're doing money. And so our children's teachers are so creative. They got some little chocolate coins. And so they've been having a wonderful time. And the kids are learning that God wants them to follow Jesus and be his disciples just like Matthew did. So it's a wonderful, wonderful lesson. Well, some of you know, if you follow me on Facebook, that this past weekend We celebrated my grandson's first birthday. It is hard to believe that that little baby is now a year old. Yes, this was us. We went to Tampa. He had a pirate-themed birthday, and this was the pirate ship. My daughter made this cake for him. He had never eaten sugar before. He ate half of that cake. And I think he's got diabetes now. I don't know. But he likes the sugar now. So we had a wonderful time celebrating him over in Tampa this past weekend. When his mom, who is my daughter, Taylor, when Taylor was just a little bit older than him, one night we were giving her a bath, and she was in the bathtub and playing with her toys. She loved taking a bath and splashing in the water, just having a fun time. And she stood up and started doing a little dance and lost her footing and fell and hit her chin on the side of the tub. We ended up in the ER that night with 5 stitches in her little chin. And every time she puts her makeup on, she's reminded of that event that we told her about years later, of standing up in the bathtub. And so now that she has a little one of her own, she has put into place some very strict rules for bath time. There is no standing. Sam already knows the consequence. If he stands up in the bathtub, we're over. It's over. Bath time's over. And he loves his bath time. So as I had the privilege of sitting next to the bathtub a couple of nights this weekend as he played with his boats, and he loves his bath and he's splashing and everything. Well, at one point, he got up on his knees and Taylor looked at him and said, "No, no, Sam, sit down." And he did. He knew. But a few minutes later, he looked at me and he looked up at her and then he looked at me and he got this huge smile on his face. And he stood up on the side and taller than he could ever be. And he was like so excited that he stood up. And she came swooping in and grabbed him and pulled him out of the tub. And she said, "All done." And he, up to which he started screaming. He was not happy about that. But did Taylor put this rule of no standing in the bathtub, did she put that into effect because she's a mean mom and she doesn't want her little boy to have fun in the bath? Absolutely not. She put that rule in effect to protect him. She put the rule into effect because she loves him and she wants safety for him. She imposed this rule because as a parent, she has the responsibility to keep him safe. So would we all agree that Taylor, as the mama, has the right to set the rules when it comes to her child? Yes, she has the right to set the rules. Does she also have the right to set the consequences if you disobey those rules? Yes, as a mom, you did the same thing, right? I think this is what we're looking at in chapter 20 of the book of Leviticus this morning. We see this exact same principle. God, as the parent of his children, the Israelites, he has the right and the responsibility to set the rules. I think we can all agree, doesn't God, the creator of the universe, he has the right to set the rules, right? Right? We should all be nodding in agreement. Yes, he has the right to set the rules. And what we see this morning is that God is telling the Israelites in advance of their journey to the promised land, here are the rules for holy living. And we've looked at these rules for several weeks now. We've been inundated with rules and commands, right? But God also says, if you choose to disobey my rules, there will be serious consequences. So not only, wouldn't we agree, he has the right to set the rules, doesn't he have the right to set the consequences for his rules also? And that's what we see this morning. Sin has consequences. You and I live in a world that treats sin very, very casually. And it is very easy for us to get pulled down by the world. And sometimes we start looking at sin as casual also. Is that right? Am I the only one? I mean, it is easy to do. But God has a perspective on sin that looks at all sin, as deadly serious because it separates him from his children. It is only by His grace that we can come back into fellowship with a loving and holy God. And thank you, Lord, that His grace is big enough to cover any and all sin. Okay? So that's where we're going this morning. The context, in order to get the context of this chapter for teaching purposes, I thought it would be best to start toward the end of the chapter, toward the end of chapter 20. Let's start in verse 23 here. God is telling His people, "And you shall not walk in the customs of the nation that I am driving out before you, for they did all these things, and therefore I detested them." Let's remember where we are in our journey. The title of this year's study is From the Red Sea to the Jordan River, right? So where are we? We're down at Sinai, and we're getting ready. God is getting ready to lead His people to the promised land, to the land of milk and honey, right? What a great journey. And you don't want to miss next week, because guess what? Next week we saddle up and head out. We start heading toward the promised land finally next week, right? But before they get on the road, as we've talked about for the last several weeks, God is giving them instruction and rules for living a holy and obedient life. And He's going to demand that they live by His rules. We looked last week and this week and the weeks prior to that. God is preparing His children not only for the military battles that they'll come up against, but for the spiritual battles that they will come up against, because they're going out into a land of pagans and they will see things that they had not encountered before. So they need to be ready and have that armor on and holiness about them. As this verse tells us, this verse 23, the promised land, which is Canaan, okay, at the time it's Canaan, it will later become what we know as Israel. That promised land is occupied. It's not wilderness. There's people living there, right? And God's going to move them out. So who are the people that are living there? Well, it's people called the Canaanites. Imagine that. Canaanites live in Canaan. The Canaanites are also, they're also known as the Amorites, is another name for them. They are descendants of Noah. Okay, Noah's grandson was a man by the name of Canaan. Okay, so these are hundreds and hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years later, the Canaanites have settled in this land, the land of milk and honey, and they are practicing, as God just said, all of these heinous sins that you read about in detail in this chapter 20. This is their daily life. This is how they live. They are pagan. They are evil people. Okay. So God is saying, look, what is the point? I am not going to displace them, a pagan people, only for you to come in there and pick up on their same habits and their same worship practices. You have to know who you are. You have to be holy and righteous and know that before you go in there, because there's going to be lots of temptation to be drugged down into the worldly pagan lifestyle that they are leaving behind. Now, He's telling them, you are holy. That's what I want you, how I want you to live when you get to the promised land. Now, they weren't holy. This is very important that we understand this. Israel isn't holy because they're better than anybody else. They're holy because God chose them. He chose them to be separate for Himself. That's why they're holy. God gave Israel His holy law and His commands, and He told them, you need to obey My rules, and you need to separate yourselves from the pagan lifestyles that they're living. And he's not saying you need to never associate with them. What He's trying to, this is a picture of you are going out there to be a light for My glory, so that these pagan people will say, I don't want to worship multiple gods anymore. I want to come and worship the one true and living God that I see you worshiping. They were supposed to be a light that attracts people to Him. In other words, God is saying, don't allow the world to drag you down to its standard. I've used this example before. I'm going to ask Tracy to come up here and help me if you've been with me in teaching, you've probably seen this example, but I think it's just such a great picture. When we talk about lifting people up or dragging people down, I'm going to try and lift Tracy up. And I have been working a little bit on my muscles. And she's only about as big as a minute, so I should be able to lift her, right? But I cannot, and I'm really trying, I cannot lift her up. But the opposite of that, let's see, she's going to try and drag me down. And it's a gravity thing, and we've broken the mic now. But it is the point is, thank you, Tracy, you did a great job. Vanna, did we break the thing? No, here, I'll just put it in my pocket. So the point is, it is a whole lot easier for us, for them, to be drugged down to the world standards than it is for us to lift people up. It is not impossible. We're called to lift people up, right? But that's why it takes prayer and diligence and faithfulness to the Lord. So God is encouraging them. Don't let them drag you down, okay? He's warning them. We're going out into this wilderness, and you're going to see things, and they're going to do things that are going to probably be shocking to you because this is who they were. And he says, I don't want them to drag you down. I want you to stay a holy people. But if you do allow them to drag you down, there are going to be severe consequences. So let's start looking at some of these rules that God institutes in this chapter. The first instruction was, he says, don't give your children to Molech. So what is that all about? Molech was a god that the Canaanites worshipped. I think, Rochelle, we have a picture of this. He was an idol, a false god. He was in the form of a man with a cow's head. He was in a seated position on his throne with his arms outstretched. He was made of bronze. And when they would worship, they would light a big, huge fire underneath him. And the people would bring their children as a form of worship and place their children in the hands and watch their children burn to death. Truly horrifying behavior. And I think God is shooting an arrow across the bow of Israel and saying, if you dare dabble in the worship, not only of this God, but any God other than me, there are going to be serious consequences for you. That's how serious God is about idol worship and worshiping someone, turning to someone other than him. Now, I wish I could say that they listened and yes, it was all good. But we're going to see as we continue our march through the Old Testament, they fall into idol worship time and time and time again. In fact, King Solomon builds an altar or a high place to Molech. I mean, it's shocking, right? But God says, this is morally wrong. This is idol worship. The consequence of this is death. Next, God addresses the occult. And the reason this is so serious to God is when you go to a medium or someone who professes to be talking to the dead, you are seeking wisdom and advice from someone other than the Lord. So in essence, this is idol worship also, right? God is very, very clear. He doesn't stutter in the scriptures when it comes to the occult. He says, don't do it. So if this is something that maybe, yeah, just for fun, I would just say, don't do it. Don't do it. Verse 9. For anyone who curses his father or his mother shall surely be put to death. He has cursed his father or his mother. His blood is upon him. So in a cursory reading of this, we look at this and we go, wow, that punishment doesn't fit that crime. That's not fair. That's not right. We think, wow, if only, you know, every time I had my kids sass me, oh, that's rough. But this isn't talking about back-talking and sassing. This isn't talking about your children literally screaming obscenities at you. This is more an idea of your children going to a deity, a false god, and pleading with that deity to rain down curses of harm onto your parents. So this is evil. And again, back to idol worship, okay? I think we see here God places such a value on the family and the parental unit that he has placed over his family, because a family is the foundation of our society, correct? If the families crumble, then society crumbles. And I think it's kind of like the Jenga game. You know, you pull the bottom, the foundation out of a Jenga game, the whole thing crumbles, right? And throughout this text, just like in this verse 9, it says, he has cursed his father and his mother. His blood is upon him. When it says that term, his blood is upon him, that's the same thing. That's the equivalent of saying he doesn't have anyone to blame himself but himself. Because God has given you in the instruction. He's told you the consequences. And you have chosen to do it anyway. So you don't have anyone to blame but yourself for what comes. The next section, really the remainder of the chapter, deals with sexual impurity. And really, we can take all of these verses dealing with sexual impurity, and we can link all of them back to God's sixth commandment, thou shalt not commit adultery. Now, when you and I hear the word adultery in our culture, we think of that in a very, I think, narrow parameter, as one partner in a marriage having sexual relationships with someone else other than their spouse, right? That's what we think of as adultery. I think God's view of adultery is much broader than that. Because we see in Scripture so many times the marriage illustration as a metaphor for God's covenant relationship with the church, right? We see that time and time again. And in that covenant relationship, he, God, is loving, he is faithful, he is committed to the covenant that he has entered into. And so anytime someone breaks that covenant and steers away from him or his teachings or what he says, that is adultery. And we're told that in Scripture over and over again. So that's the big picture of what this is looking at. But when we look at the sexual part of adultery, I think anything that compromises God's original view of marriage that we find in Genesis chapter 2, one man and one woman, anything that compromises that, I believe, is breaking his covenant and is considered as adultery. As we said earlier, he has the right to set the rules. These are there are consequences. You read about them. They're severe. You looked at the derivations of adultery. Many of them were punishable by death. Sleeping with your neighbor's wife is death. Sleeping with your father's wife is death. Sleeping with your daughter-in-law is death. Homosexual sex is death. Sleeping with a woman and her mother is death. Having sex with an animal brings death. All of these are capital crimes. Everything that's been mentioned so far, all of the other stuff, capital crimes. And we think in 2020, wow, that doesn't deserve the death penalty, does it? But I think what we need to understand as believers and followers of the Lord Jesus Christ is that God views every sin as a capital crime and worthy of death. Romans 6:23 says, for the wages of sin is death. That means the payment required for sin is death. But the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. And thank goodness he has provided a way for us through his son's substitutionary death. Jesus Christ on the cross took on the death penalty for you and I so that we may be set free and have life everlasting. Thank you, Lord, right? Thank you, Jesus, for that gift of grace. But let us never forget that there is no such thing as a small sin in God's eyes. We want to rank them. because that's our human nature. But God doesn't rank sin. It all separates us from God. And I think sometimes we are not, I've said this before, we're not sufficiently horrified by sin. Even the little sin that we consider in our life. We don't see that as God sees it. You know, when Adam and Eve took that apple off the tree, let's just ate an apple. Does that deserve the death penalty for all of humanity? Absolutely. Absolutely. And it's only when we begin to view sin, all sin, my sin, your sin, it's only when we begin to view sin as a horrible crime against a holy God that we will ever really be truly able to understand His majesty. And I think a lot of us have trouble getting there, but we need to ask the Lord to lead us to that place where we see all sin as horrifying to God. So, the rules and the consequences that God gave to His children, He gave them not to be mean, but because He loves them and He's trying to protect them, and He has called them to be holy as they go forward into all this pagan world. Don't get dragged down by the world. Stay holy. Remain holy. Be holy. Over the last few weeks, we've read a lot about these rules that God gave, a lot about the commands and the instructions that He has given for holy living. Now, some of them still apply to us as New Testament believers, but others don't. And so that has brought up the question, well, how do we decide? Well, who picks and chooses which ones carry over to the New Testament believers? Well, I'll tell you, I am not smart enough to determine that. So I have relied on biblical scholars to guide me, and I've allowed the Lord to guide me in prayer and in study. And I have come down to a certain position. And so what I'm about to say is what I believe based on study and prayer, based on a very well-known Christian theology. But I will tell you, there are those who don't agree. Okay? So here's where I come down on which laws span from the Old Testament to the New. There are, in the Old Testament, and we've been looking at them, there are three different kinds of laws. Oh gosh, I'm going to go way late. I apologize, y'all. There are moral law, there is ceremonial law, and there is civil law. Moral law are the broad scheme of laws that are really based on the Decalogue or the Ten Commandments. These are laws that are part of the creative order. In other words, they transcend time and space and culture. The moral law is based on the character of God, so it never changes and it is forever applicable. So the moral law, yes, carries over to the New Testament, and we are expected to follow the moral law. Ceremonial law. So these are the rituals that we've read about in great detail. These are things like the sacrifices, the festivals, the rules for being clean versus unclean and how to get clean again, okay? And the rules about the tabernacle, okay? So all these laws were given to Israel for the purpose of having them be able to purify themselves in order to come before a holy God. So are we required to follow these ceremonial laws? No, because Jesus Christ, who was the foreshadowing of all the sacrifices and the tabernacle and the cleansing and all that, Jesus Christ has purified us once and for all, and so we don't have to continually be purifying ourselves because Jesus has done that and that has been completed for us. And then finally, the civil law, these were things like things like divorce and laws about dress code and inheritance. And these were things that had to do with their particular government at their particular time. And it was a theocratic government. In other words, God was the head of the government. And so this was something that, and it under the civil law, listen, comes the penalty part. So we have the moral law of thou shalt not commit adultery. The civil law is you will be stoned to death. Does the civil law still apply? No, because we are not under that same time and place. So the civil law doesn't apply to us. The moral law still does. Thou shalt not commit adultery. But we're not stoned to death for it, okay? So in my opinion, all of the things that we read about today, everything in this chapter 20, are part of the moral law. Because all of them harken back to the Ten Commandments. And they are all still applicable to where we live in 2020. But look here, there are some people who might say that, oh yeah, but there are sins in this chapter. They're the big ones. Those are the big ones. And we need to make sure that people don't do that. And we don't want them in our church. And we need to get rid of people that are committing those big sins. Well, you know what God says about that? Romans 3:23, all, not some, all have sinned and fallen short of God's glory. There are no small sins and greater sins. It's all sin, and it all separates us from the Lord God. And as Jesus, you read in the scriptures today, as Jesus said, he who is without sin, cast the first stone. But does that mean we close our eyes and ignore family members or friends who may be entangled in something that they shouldn't be? Absolutely not. But there's a proper biblical way to handle that. And I don't think, or I know, the proper way is not to condemnationally judge them and call them out and scream at them and act holier than thou. The way to handle this is one broken sinner to another, offering them the grace that he has bestowed on you and the love and the redemption and the freedom that only comes with a relationship in Jesus Christ. You and I are both sinners in need of a Savior. A Savior who has the right and the responsibility to set the rules and the consequences for breaking them. But I can tell you, if we continue to abdicate to mainstream culture and allow mainstream secular culture to set the rules of morality, then we will continue to drift further away from His holiness. We live in a world that treats sin very casually. And sometimes we are tempted to fall and get drugged down into that and treat sin casually as well. From God's perspective, all sin is deadly serious. But there's grace. And there is no sin that is so great that His grace cannot forgive. Let's pray. Father God, I just pray that these words that you have given me to share have fallen softly on hearts in this crowd. Father, I thank you that you set the rules. Forgive us when we don't follow them. It is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.